a place I can run to. Every piece of my pride now I give away. You're the hope that I cling to. There's nothing like falling right into the arms of the Father. Here in your presence, I'm caught in a love like no other. This feels like heaven. Nothing is missing.
Hey, good morning. It is a good morning. Why don't we have everybody stand up with us? We want to take a moment to welcome you to church today. If you are in the building, we are so glad that you are here. If you're watching us online, we want to welcome you. Why don't you take a moment and just let us know where you're watching from? You can say couch, right? You can say coffee room. You can say living room, whatever. Just let us know where you're watching from. Give us a wave emoji so we know you're there. It's good to participate because worship is a participation sport. It's a contact sport. It's a time that we worship together. It's so important that we do that. A couple of weeks ago, you know, I talked about the difference between availability and accessibility. We have so many things that are available to us. We have the promises of God that are available to us. But those promises become accessible to us when we worship Him. It lifts the lid. It opens the door when we begin to worship Him. And I heard something this week that just sort of messed with my mind. And it was this. He was the person that was talking, I don't even remember who was talking at this point, but he was saying that when we praise God in advance of the blessing. Listen to me, because this is so important. When we praise God in advance of the blessing, that's faith. We're proclaiming the goodness of God and what He's going to do as if He's already done it. In faith, believing that God's word is final. When we thank God and we worship Him for what He has done, we're being thankful. And it's important that we do both. It's important that we remember what God has done for us, but that we stand firm on the promises that God will do. It's important that we remember that God is who He says He is, that He will do what He said He would do, and that He is not a liar, and that He will never change. Amen? So let's enter into worship now. This is important. Listen, this is not how we worship. We don't worship like this. We don't worship with our hands in our pocket. We worship like this. And so today we're going to proclaim the goodness of God. And we've got a worship set for you. So we're going to dive right into worship. And we want to encourage you to worship. If you're at home, it may be different sitting on your couch, but we encourage you to be worshiping and thanking God for who He is. Let's not consume. Let's participate. Come on, let's worship Him.
I think we all know this song, so let's sing it together this morning.
You give life, You are love, You bring light to the darkness. You give hope, and You restore every heart that is broken. And great it's Your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's Your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to You only. Yes, we do.
Come on, You give life.
You give life, and You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope, and You restore every heart that is broken. Oh, and great are You, Lord. It's Your breath. seas that are shaken and stirred can be calmed and broken for my regard. And through it all, my eyes are on you. And through it all, it is well. Through it all, my eyes are on you, and it is well with me. Far be it from me to not believe, even when my eyes can't see, and this mountain that's in front of me will be thrown into the midst of the sea. And through it all, my eyes are on you. And through it all, in this way. Through it all, my eyes are on you, and it is well, it is well. So let go, my soul, and trust in Him. The winds and waves still know His name. So let go, trust in Him. The waves and wind still know His name. So let go, my soul, and trust in Him. The waves and wind still know His name. The waves and wind still know His name. It is well.
As they were singing and leading us in worship, I couldn't help but think, we can sing, "It is well with my soul," because God is great. You know that prayer that you teach your kids when they're little and they're getting ready to eat food, and you tell them to pray, you teach them, "God is great, God is good." And I think because we teach a child to pray that way, that we sort of dismiss the words of the prayer and we don't understand the power and the impact of the words we're talking about, because God is great. There is none above Him. God is a good God. And we overuse that word, because in our minds we use the word good, yeah, it's good, as less than best. But when we're talking about the goodness of God, we're talking about the fact that God is a good God and He wants the best for you and He has promises for you and that He'll never fail you. He'll never forsake you, because God is a good God and He is for you. Man, we've got to realize that this thing we do on Sunday is not about us. It's not about our preference. It's not about giving our time. It's about Him. And it's about glorifying and worshiping Him. It's perspective. It's perspective. Well, listen, you may be seated. I want to say thank you so much for being here today. Thank you for tuning in. If you're online with us, we want to say thank you. We want to say welcome. If you are new here in the building, then we have a card that we would love for you to fill out. You can go to the back, the connection point there, and you can take a card and fill that out. And we've got a gift for you. If you're online, there's a way that you can do that. You can text the word next, and I got to look up the number. It is 214-3186. And we would love to send you a gift just to let us know that you're there. You can send us a message. You can text next to 214-3186 and let us know that you're there. And we would love to send you something as well. Listen, the season that we're in right now is different than any season that we've been in. And this is kind of where I'm standing this week. This is where I've come to. We've got to stop using COVID-19 as a crutch and an excuse to not fill in the blank. Look, when this thing started, way back in March, remember March? Remember February? Remember those times? That was this year. Man, that seems like a lifetime ago. We thought this thing would be over in a couple of weeks. They said, give us a couple of weeks. We'll slow the curve. Well, we're about to enter into September this week, and we're still trying to figure this out. We've got to learn to live with. We've got to learn to rise above. We've got to learn to move forward in the vision that God has given us as a church and who God has called you to be. Those are connected, by the way. But we are so glad that you're here. And listen, it's important that we all do our part. The church needs you now more than ever. Because the world needs the church now more than ever. And those two things are also connected. The church needs you. The church needs you to do your part. And if we all just pull together, each one of us do our part, man, God would do so much. And that reminds me, in a couple of weeks, we're going to be having what we're calling Vision Sunday in September. And on that day, what we're going to do is we're going to cast the vision for moving into our next facility, moving into our next phase. Hey, listen, y'all. 5 Sundays from today, we will be sitting in a new location. We'll be sitting in our brand new building. It's time that we get excited about it, right? It's weird times right now, but we are moving into a brand new building. That means we have 3 more physical Sundays here. And 3 more Sundays we'll be having live service physically here in this building. And then the last Sunday of September, we're going to be online only. And we've got some special plans for that online service as we begin to move, break down, and take everything to the new building, 48 Brookfield Oaks. Drive. I've got to get used to saying that. But it's going to be a good thing because God has blessed us. And it's because of your generosity. Because of your generosity that we're able to do those things, that we're able to exist, that we're able to move into the next building because you are generous. Thank you for being generous. And I just want to say, if you've already given, thank you so much for giving. Thank you so much for trusting God with your finances by doing your part. It's so important that we understand that. The system that God set up was for us to bring the tithe, the 10% of what comes in, to Him because it's His. And then we give it above and beyond. The abundance of the blessing opens up those blessings into our life. And we just want to say thank you for doing your part and for trusting God with your finances and who you are. The other thing that's coming up that's very, very important to me. Very important to me. This 21 days of fasting is going to be different than any 21 days of fasting we've done before. We're going to begin that on September the 14th. We're going to fast for 21 days, and we're going to end that fast on October 4th, the very first Sunday in our brand new building. And we need to be praying and believing for God to give us breakthrough and miracles and signs and wonders. Y'all remember way back in January, it seems like, is it just me, or does it seem like January was like a lifetime ago? Remember January? We did our 21 days of fasting, and we prayed, and we saw miracles take place. We saw a bona fide, true blue miracle take place in our service right in front of us. I am believing God for greater miracle and for breakthrough in these next 21 days of fasting that we will do. So join us. Make it an intentional time because it's so, so important. Hey, listen, I want to pray for us because I believe God's given a word today. If you haven't heard or listened to the messages the last couple of weeks, I would encourage you to go back and listen to those messages because I believe God is directing us in the season that we're in to go on a path. And he's given us instruction to accomplish his purpose and his plan. And today, I just ask that you would pray with me. Will you do that? Will you pray with me? If you want to give today, I need to tell you how to do that. If you're in person, we've got generosity boxes in the back. We do have tithe envelopes to give you. If you're online, you can give. They're going to put the ways to give up in person. That also applies, or online. That also applies to you who are here in person. That's what I was trying to say. There are ways to give for you to do your part. And I just want to ask you to pray over the service today, that God would direct and guide us. Heavenly Father, Lord, we love you and we thank you, God, for your goodness and your mercy. God, you are great and you are good. And Lord, we trust you. God, we ask that you would move today. God, move in our midst. Move in a mighty way today, God. Show up, Lord, that we would see life change take place. God, we might be used to packed rooms, but Lord, things are different right now. But God, you have not changed. And Lord, we just ask that you would be with us today. Help us, God. Anoint us. I pray that you'd open our hearts and ears to receive your word, God. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, when I pray that prayer, asking God to open our hearts and ears, it's not just something that I say. I mean that with all of my heart. I want God to open our hearts and our ears because the one of the worst things that you could do right now is that you could be the person that hears the word and you hear the point and you think, yeah, that's right. So-and-so needs to hear that one. Boy, I hope they're paying attention. I got news for you. That may be true, but if you're thinking that, it might be you that needs to hear it. And it's important that we enter into not only the time of worship with the right attitude and the right mindset, but that we enter into God's word in this time where he shares his word. It's important that we also enter into this time. This week I was praying about what to talk to you about and kind of what to bring, and God led me to one of my favorite passages in the Bible. So if you want to open up to Matthew chapter 8, we're going to be reading verses 5 through 13. And this is an incredible passage because any time that you're reading Jesus stopping, right? So Jesus is walking through, and any time that he stops and he says, whoa, take notice of this, I want to take notice of that. And look, I, right now in our country, you know, our country, man, it's a bit of a mess. And for those of us that are over a certain age, you know, we've been raised to be patriotic, and I'm patriotic. I'm grateful for those who have served our country. I'm grateful for the. My dad is an Army veteran. I have friends that I went to high school with that I haven't spoken to since, you know, so that's a tip for you high school students. You won't probably see them again, but I have friends that I went to high school with. They joined the military, right? I have kids that were not kids now, but they're grown men and women in my youth group. They went into the military, and what was interesting for me, because I kept up with them, because I'm old, and they would enter into the military, and you take a kid from Anderson, South Carolina, and you send him off to boot camp, and they go, and they're trained, and they're broken down, and it's interesting because they go to boot camp looking one way, and they come back completely different, because their job in boot camp is to break you down and then build you up, and they would go in, and they would go through the training, and they would be issued a uniform, and then they would be issued a gun, and they would go off and serve in Afghanistan and in Iraq. And going through that time, they went in one way, but they became something different. They became a soldier. And you would watch them sort of transform in their mannerisms. You would watch them begin to transform in how they interacted, just in how they looked, how they carried themselves, because they carried themselves as a soldier. As a soldier in the most powerful army representing the greatest nation in the world. I still believe that. But what was interesting is I would talk to them, and one in particular I would kind of keep up with, and he was in Afghanistan, and he was sort of policing the area. That was his job. He was literally a jailer, and he was policing the area that he was in. He said, for the most part, the people in the area were glad to see them, but there were those that hated him. There were those that hated the United States military's presence in their homeland. They wanted them dead. They wanted them away, and they wished them great harm. They wished that they were dead, right? And what he said is that even though that they were there and they had people around them that absolutely hated their existence, those people that hated them and wanted to cause harm to them still had to submit to their authority because of who they represented. This kid from Anderson, South Carolina, with a uniform and a gun in the United States of Army, was not powerful because he looked like the Incredible Hulk. He was not powerful because he could shoot straight and he could hit a target from far away. He wasn't powerful just because of the squad that he traveled with. He was most powerful because of who he represented. He was there on direct orders, when you think about it, from the President of the United States, the most powerful man in the world, representing the most powerful nation in the world, part of the most powerful military in the world, representing the greatest people in the world, the United States of America. There's my patriotic speech. And he was there representing that. And it was because of all of that that he had the power and the authority for the people that hated him the most to have to respect him and do what he said do. Are you getting it? You and I are part of something that is so much greater than you can be individually and on your own. You and I are part of something so much greater because we're part of the church, the big C church that God established through Jesus Christ that he is the head of. And it is time for us to stop taking a back seat to the enemy and to the world and to the stuff that's going on, and just laying down and taking it. It's time for the church to get fired up. It's time for the church to get a little angry. It's time for the church to begin to step into and to walk into who we are. Now, y'all gonna make me want to kick over the podium or something, but come on, y'all got to talk to me. If you're in the chat, say amen. Come on, let us rise up. The analogy isn't so far off from us. The analogy of the soldier is not that far off, because in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12 and 13 says this, For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers and rulers of darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. Period. Verse 12. You just read that and you think, okay, that ain't good. Now what? Verse 13. If you're an underliner, if you're a highlighter in your Bible, if you're a circler, circle verse 13, because it says, therefore, as in, hey, it's there for a reason. Listen to what I'm about to say. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God. Now, when you think about the armor of God, anybody else think about military? Anybody else? Think about a fighter, anybody else? Think about a soldier. Take up the whole army of God. And look at the next line. That you may be able to withstand in the evil day. Anybody else think we might be in an evil day? Come on, anybody else seeing the world that we are living in and thinking, God, Are you paying attention? You may have missed that message last week, so I would encourage you to go back and listen to it. God, are you paying attention? Because he is. But we are in an evil day, and I believe we are in the last days. I believe that's why we've got to have this sense of urgency when it comes to living in the job and the mission of the church. So that you'll be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. And then he goes on and he lists the armor of God. I would encourage you to read Ephesians chapter 6 and read the armor of God, the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, the shield of faith, the sword of the Spirit. Having your feet prepared with the sharing the gospel of Christ. It's important to know that we're in a spiritual battle. But the armor of God is not only available to us, it is accessible to us. But look at what the scripture says. It says that you're not going to wake up in the morning and some robot's not going to come like Iron Man and put your suit on for you. It says that you've got to put it on. You've got to make a conscious decision to say, you know what? I am saved and I'm going to keep my mind protected from the junk of the world. You can't watch half of what's on Netflix without being the stuff you listen to, the stuff that you watch matters. I'm going to go old school youth pastor on you. Junk in, junk out. If you're inputting junk into your spirit and you're inputting junk into your mind and into your heart, guess what's going to come out eventually? It's going to affect how you live. You've got to make the decision to put on the armor of God. And that's not even what I'm preaching today. But they're accessible to you, but you've got to put it on. And I want you to understand something. I am not a preacher. I am not a pastor that sees the devil around every corner. I'm not the guy that thinks, I got a flat tire, man. The devil sure is beating me up today. No, you just ran over a nail. Or you ran and hit the curb, and that's what happens to tires when you do that. Ain't the devil. You can't drive. I'm just saying. I've done it. So, I'm not that guy. I'm not the guy that wakes up and has a bad day and just thinks it's like this, woo. But God was very clear to me this week. I believe with all of my heart, because I believe God has directed me this way, that we are under a spiritual oppression. And this is what spiritual oppression is. Oppression is when you have this sense of doom and gloom. Oppression, not depression, oppression is when you have this sense of what's going to happen, fear of the worst, are we going to make it, is God in control? And you're oppressed into this time where you feel like there is no hope. But as long as you're alive, and as long as Christ is in you, and as long as you are the temple of the Holy Spirit, guess what? You have hope inside of you, and those that are outside that are not Christians are looking to you for that hope. We're in this spirit of oppression right now. And I'm talking about the church, the Big C church that Jesus came to establish. And I'm talking about Turning Point Church, because we're part of that church. Man, I'm telling you, I love y'all, but I'm having to deal with y'all. And people are just going through it right now. People are just in this spiritual funk, where they're just sort of, and you're just being bombarded constantly from the world. But you're not getting up every day, putting your armor of God on, having your shield of faith, taking out the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, and taking it on with a battle. We're laying down and taking it, and we got to stop it. Amen, Pastor, I know. Matthew chapter 8, verse 5 through 13. Jesus is walking through, and so he's just kind of going on this great teaching experience where he Sermon on the Mount, and you know, he just rapid fires these different lessons for us to learn. And so now he's beginning to travel, and it says this great multitude is following with him. And in chapter 8, verse 5, let's read what happens. Then when Jesus had entered Capernaum, a centurion, I'll tell you what that means in a second, a centurion came to him pleading with him, saying, "Lord, my servant is lying at home, paralyzed, dreadfully tormented." And look at what Jesus said, because this is important. You got to read the Bible, and you got to see what's not written and understand what's happening. And Jesus said to him, "I'll come and heal him." And look at the centurion's answer. The centurion answered and said, "Lord, I am not worthy that you would come under my roof, but only speak a word and my servant will be healed. For I also am a man under authority, having soldiers under me. And I say to this one, go, and he goes. And I say to another, come, and he comes. And I say to my servant, do this, and he does it." Look at verse 10. "And when Jesus heard it, he marveled." I bet you guys haven't used that word ever. "He marveled and said to those who followed, 'Assuredly, I say to you, I have not found such great faith,'" look at this little detail, "'not even in Israel. And I say to you that many will come from the east and the west and sit down with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But sons of the kingdom will be cast out into outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth.' Then Jesus said to the centurion, 'Go your way, and as you have believed, so let it be done for you.' And his servant was healed in the same hour." Now, this story is one of my favorites, and it's sort of chalked full of stuff for us to take out of. But first thing you need to understand is this man that came him was labeled a centurion. That was his title in the Roman army, the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire was taking over the world. They were battle ready, man. They were, you know, kind of mean and vicious, and they were very aggressive. And this man was a centurion, which means that he led a battalion or a group of 100 soldiers. And he would have been battle tested. He would have seen many, many battles, because his job was to train the soldiers to go into battle, and then he would lead them into battle on the front line. So this wasn't a guy sitting in a chariot barking out orders from afar. This was a guy that was in the trenches with the soldiers leading 100 men. And he would have been battle tested. He would have been a very disciplined man. I kind of imagine, you know, what was the movie with the guy with the beard that got put in jail and he came out, and what was that movie? What's his name? Anyway, I kind of imagine Russell Crowe, you know. I don't imagine him being buff. I kind of imagine him being all chiseled and mean looking. And that guy comes to Jesus. It would have taken 15 to 20 years for this guy to get to where he was. He was a battle-hardened soldier that was used to fighting. He was used to ordering men. He was used to being in charge of prisoners. He would have had many, many servants. He would have had 100 soldiers underneath his command. And look how he comes to Jesus. Both times he addresses Jesus, what does he say? He starts the sentence with, "Lord." I think it would do us good if we would address Lord as Lord of our life. If we would give him control of our life so that we acknowledge that he is in charge. The reason that some... Oh, man, this is not in my note. It gets dangerous when I share things off my note. But the reason some of you are in the shape that you are is because you're not trusting God with all you have. God, I just can't get out of debt. I can't get out of this thing. I just have this mountain of bills. I just have this mountain of woe is me. And I paid my tithe that one time 5 years ago and nothing happened. I got news for you. It's not going to happen until you say, Lord, you're in charge of my life. I give it to you because it's yours anyway. I'm just stewarding what God gave you. You want God's blessing? Let him be Lord of your life. And this man recognizes that Jesus is also a man that is under authority because structure was his life. If you are in the military, or if you know someone that is in the military, like a lifer military guy, right? We had the opportunity to connect with, through someone in the church, a gentleman that was a sergeant, is a drill sergeant in the Army, and now he takes kids and he gives them discipline and he gives them, you know, a life skills, and he kind of takes them down a different path. And we were, I'm an observer, right? I'm an observer of human nature. And I'm watching him, and when he told me how old he was, I couldn't believe that he was a lot older than me and way better shape. And so he's sitting there, and everything he did was, you know, just systematic and robotic and just to the T and to the detail and the P's and the Q's and the I's and the T's. This man was a man of discipline, and he was used to structure. And he saw in Jesus that he wasn't there doing his own thing. He wasn't there accomplishing his own agenda, but he was there with a bigger purpose. And there's something I want to point out to you. This man comes to Jesus. He says, Lord, I recognize that you are in higher authority. But Lord, my servant needs to be healed. He didn't say, notice, there are other accounts in the Bible where a father comes to Jesus and says, Jesus, will you come to my house? Will you come to my house and heal? Will you come? Will you come with me? That's not what he said. The centurion soldier comes to Jesus and he says, Lord, my servant needs healing. And look at what Jesus responds. I'll come to your house and I'll heal him. Jesus will always give you more than what you ask for. This man did not ask for Jesus to come, but Jesus said, I will come and heal your servant. Jesus will always give you more than what you ask for. Now, let me give you a little life leadership lesson. This is free. There are people in your life who will ask you a question that they already know the answer to. And there are people in your life who typically will only ask a question that they know the answer to. And there's two reasons for somebody to do that. One, they're trying to manipulate you. Two, there's a lesson to be learned. And with Jesus, I don't think he's ever asked a question that he didn't know the answer to. How many times do we read in the Bible where Jesus read the minds of the people in the room? And so Jesus, I believe with all of my heart, knew the centurion's intention before the centurion ever showed up. I believe he knew his intention before he ever asked the question, before he ever opened his mouth, but he let him happen anyway because there was a lesson to be learned, a lesson about the Father's business and the Father's kingdom. And so he let him ask these questions, and Jesus said, I'll come heal you. And the centurion said, whoa, no, I don't need you to come. I just need you to say the word. I just need you to say the word. And the centurion recognized that Jesus was there on a larger purpose, that he was selfless, others-focused, God-centered, that Jesus was a servant leader. We could take and apply that, and if we hear nothing else today, we should model that. That's why we say model Jesus, love our neighbors. This interaction between Jesus and the centurion is important because we can learn some things from how the centurion approaches Jesus. First of all, he approaches him in humility. He calls him Lord every time he speaks to him. He comes to Jesus in submission. Acknowledging that Jesus is greater. He doesn't come demanding. He comes honoring. Curl your toes up for a second, but listen to what I'm about to say. As important as the centurion was in his world, he knew that this situation was something that only Jesus could handle, that only Jesus could cover. He didn't come into the situation and approach Jesus with his entourage. He didn't come and approach Jesus, "Don't you know who I am?" He didn't come to Jesus proud and haughty. He just came to Jesus in humility and he said, "Lord, this is what's happening. This is what's going on." It would do us so much good to recognize that only Jesus can change our situation. How would your prayer life change if you entered that prayer time acknowledging that God was in control and that only He could change your situation? How would it change your prayer time if you went to Jesus with open ears rather than an open mouth? There's a reason God gave you 2 ears and one mouth. You should listen twice as much as you talk. And some of us, the problem is that we come into our time with God and we just want to tell Him what we need Him to do. "God, I got it all figured out. Now I just need You to make it happen." How would our prayer life change if we went into it listening rather than talking? Trusting rather than demanding? I don't know. I'm just asking. The man says, "I'm not worthy, but You just say the word, and I know that You will change. My servant would be healed." And I love verse 8 because the man says, "I too am a man that is under authority." Listen. This man understood the power of submission. In order for you to be in authority, you have to be under authority of someone or something. Or an organization. If you're going to be in authority and you're going to have any authority, you've got to be under authority of someone or something. The problem in the church world is that we just want people to listen to us and do what we say, but we're not intent on hearing what God has to say to us. Operating under authority means tapping into resources, having more availability to you to do things, to be able to call upon a specialist when needed, to be able to have the backing of greater resources than you've ever had on your own, being part of something greater than you. Remember my story about the kid from Anderson, right? The uniform, the gun, the platoon he traveled with, the nation he represented. The enemy that despised him had to submit to him because he was part of something greater than he would have been on his own. And they never traveled alone. The problem with the church today is we got a bunch of dadgum lone rangers out there trying to do their own thing, trying to make their own thing happening, trying to change the world on their own, and they're just spinning their wheels. And I believe that in this season, God is taking the voice away from some people and He is giving it to others. And who He's given it to is yet to be found. But listen, it's time for the church to change. We've been so focused on the mode, and we've confused the mode of how we do things with the mission. The mission has not changed. They are stronger collectively than we are alone. This is why you need the church. This is why you need to be part of a local fellowship. I am convinced the reason we are overwhelmed, the reason we are overloaded, the reason we are crawling into a hole, the reason that we are shutting down and shutting people out, is because we're missing the fellowship of the church. Thank God for online that we're able to do this. Thank God that we're able to offer. Thank God that we're able to do. I just don't think there's anything that's going to replace us coming together, and lifting our hands, and worshiping God collectively, praising Him. Don't skim past verse 10. Because really, this is kind of my point. When Jesus heard it, the Bible said He marveled at the faith of the centurion. Now listen, again, you got to think about what's actually happening in the scripture that you read. Because you got to understand there was a multitude of people, and the people that were in that crowd were His disciples, were Pharisees, were scribes, religious leaders, townspeople, Jewish people, Gentiles. The Jewish people had a corner on God. They were God's chosen, and in their mind that God was for them and nobody else. We got to get out of that mentality. We got to share the gospel. And when Jesus stopped, He marveled. He said, I've never seen such great faith. Imagine being one of Jesus' disciples. And Jesus, your leader, says, whoa, stop. Never have I seen such great faith. Don't you just imagine Peter being like, what you talking about? I'm here. Imagine the Pharisees' reaction. What do you mean you've not seen? Don't you know who I am? And there you have the difference between a Gentile centurion soldier and a religious Jewish person. One felt entitled and one was humble. One was trying to cast Jesus out, the other was calling Him Lord. And that brings hope. Because the centurion soldier was a Gentile. And you know what that means? You and I have hope that we can be adopted into the family of God. That we can be adopted into who He is. Because the centurion soldier called Him Savior. And Jesus accepted him. And you can be adopted into the family of God. And when you're adopted into the family of God, all the rights of being part of the family of the Heavenly Father is open, available, and accessible. You just got to get up every morning. You got to put on the full armor of God, and you got to walk in the calling that God has given. Leadership lesson number 2, true success happens in succession. This is important. True success happens in succession. Let me show you what I mean. If I'm sick, and they can't figure out what's going on, and I'm laying in a hospital bed, or I'm laying on my bed, and you think I'm dying, or you think, oh no, we don't know what's going to happen. Here's what I don't want you to do. I don't want you to bring me a medical terminology book. I don't want you to bring me a library from the medical library and give me a bunch of books. Those books contain the facts, the historical data, to stand behind the treatments that I need in order to get better. But I don't need a book that tells me about it. What I need is a doctor, because a doctor represents the things that are in the book. He embodies the person that represents the book that tells me, with the knowledge and the experience, that he's able to treat me and to do what I need him to do. The same is true. We don't just have a book. Jesus came. John chapter 1 says that the Word was and the Word became flesh. And true success happens in succession, because Jesus, if He would have just been here, He would have done miracles, He would have did His thing, and then He would have left. You and I would have been alone. But Jesus says in John chapter 14, hey, not only are you going to do what I do, but you're going to do it greater than what I was able. He wasn't talking about in the magnitude of the specific miracle that He did. He was talking about the magnitude of the body of Christ coming together through the power of the Holy Spirit who lives inside of us. and anoints us to do His work. True success comes in succession. And Jesus became flesh, and the Holy Spirit who brought Him out of the grave is alive and well in you, available and accessible. You just got to open up to it. Here's something I've learned. You may not always have the power to control your life, especially right now. But you always have the power to submit and surrender. Somebody needs to write that down. You may not always have the power to control, but you always have the power to submit and surrender. And that's just saying, God, I trust You. I trust You. I'm going to ask you to stand with me. Listen, I don't know what you're going through today. I have an idea. I don't know what you're facing today. I have an idea. But here's what I know. You don't know what I'm going through. You don't know what I'm facing. You don't know how I'm processing this. You don't know how I'm dealing with this. We've got to start being others focused. We got to start putting others first. We got to start submitting to God. We got to put on our armor of God. We've got to start walking in the calling that God has called us, the person, the Christ that God has called us to be. So wherever you are, whatever you're going through today, I want to pray for you. With every head bowed, every eye closed, let me just ask you a question. You just feel like right now you can't do it. Guess what? You can't on your own. You feel like, God, I'm spinning my wheels, Lord. The faster I go, the deeper in the mud I get. Because you're trying to do it on your own. Submit and surrender. And I just want to ask you to do this today. If you would just raise your hands right now. Come on, raise your hands with me. Say, God, I surrender to You. God, I surrender to You, Lord. I submit to Your authority. If you're in this place today and you're watching online and you don't have a relationship with God, start one right now. God, forgive me of my sins. I know, Jesus, that You came to this earth to die for me, and I accept You as my Savior. I surrender and I submit to You, God. Forgive me of my sins and help me to live for You. God, I pray in the name of Jesus that You would be with our church today. Those that are watching, those in person, those that are carrying a burden, God, You would uplift them, undergird them, and strengthen them, Lord. God, I pray that each one of us would understand that we've got to surrender and submit to You. And God, every day we've got to make the choice to wear the whole armor of God, not just part of it. God, I pray that You would be with us as we move forward. And God, help us to be there for those that we come in contact with. To be others-focused, others-centered, Lord. God-centered. And God, we just ask it all. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Aren't y'all glad we don't have to do this on our own? Aren't y'all glad we don't have to do this on our own? Come on. There we go. I got three things for y'all before you go. Listen, three more weeks in this building, we're going to the new building. Can I get a whoop whoop? There we go. And in was about 2 weeks, we're doing our 21 days of fasting and our last announcement. I need y'all to invite somebody next week, whether it be inviting them to watch online. We invited somebody today, sent them a link. It's as easy as that. Or if they feel comfortable, bring them, have them sit with you this week. We love y'all. We'll see y'all next week.